So welcome to Researcher's Desk, and it's super nice today to welcome Nikki Evelpedo from the University of Athens. Nikki is a colleague of mine. She's working together with me on the Civis University Alliance. We've taught courses together for students from Athens and students from Stockholm and all over Europe. And one of the times when I was on one of these courses, Nikki told me about a completely brilliant piece of research she's doing, where we're looking at coastal protection and looking at what nature does and trying to make that happen, encouraging that along, working with nature rather than against nature to protect coasts. And it's so nice, Nikki, you're willing to spend some of your time sharing your thoughts with us at Researcher's Desk. So welcome. I'm going to hand over to you now. What I'll do is, after you've successfully shared slides, I'll turn my camera off, but I will be there in the background. All you need to do is say help and I'll jump in again. Welcome, Nikki.
Okay, great. Let me try.
That looks absolutely brilliant, Nikki. So I'm going to turn my camera off and the floor is yours.
Okay. So hello, everybody. Many thanks to Alasdair, who invited me to be here and share with you a geologically based idea on how to mitigate coastal erosion, a side effect of a climate crisis on sandy beaches, with an environmental friendly method which will not further affect the climate change. But let's discuss a little bit about coastal erosion issue as a side effect of climate change. A significant proportion of the world's sandy coastline will face coastal erosion by 2050 as a consequence of climate change, with a proportion approaching 50% by the end of this century. Based on a research of Bouzdoukas and his colleagues published in Nature, over 30% of sandy beaches are at low altitudes and their population density exceeds 500 people per square kilometer, while forecasts show that around the one third of this coast will have faced serious erosion problems in the next years. And by the end of the century, based on the most optimistic scenario, over 50% of the coast will suffer from coastal erosion, while this percentage increases to around 60% with the less optimistic climatic scenario. And just some demographic data, around 1 billion people, maybe even more, live in a low elevation coastal areas globally. And in Europe, the shoreline that will be lost is 54 meters under the moderate emission mitigation policy scenario, as you see in this slide, by the end of the century. And this is relative to the baseline year 2010. And this retreat would translate to 1,400 square kilometers of coastal land loss. So for most of the last century, building large structures of timber, concrete, or rock was considered the best way to deal with coastal erosion. So this hard engineering approach to coastal protection resulted in the creation of hard constructions on large sections of a coastline. These hard engineering constructions, such as breakwaters, coastal walls, and other measures, include concrete constructions that turn the landscape to a more industrial than natural. This is what we used to do, and this is what is happening in most of the cases still. So such constructions are financial expensive, costly, with a short time period as a lifetime. And it is important to mention that they are constructions that contribute to the second largest industrial emitter, carbon dioxide, with about 7% of global emissions. At the same time, these constructions are not beautiful, as you may see in these pictures, do not feel well with the environment, and often partially effective. Not only our coasts are under erosion, but also our cultural heritage. Here you may see an example of Deol Kos, an engineering construction of the 7th century BC in my country, in Greece. Deol Kos is an ancient Greek engineering marvel, allowed ships to travel overland for about 8 kilometers long from the Ionian Sea to Aegean Sea, bypassing the Peloponnesian Peninsula. Like the Corinth Canal, which was finally constructed a millennium later, it made the passage around the peninsula much safer for vessels. Deol Kos nowadays is under erosion because of the waves produced by ships going through Corinth Isthmus, Corinth Canal. So it was decided to be protected. And this is the result of the protection works, full of cement, and the result is so artificial that the area lost its beauty. This works is still ongoing. Now, this is the answer of the nature. This is what nature is doing to protect the environment. The reef that we see, the wave crashing on, are beach rocks, and is the area that gave us the idea to mimic the nature to create such a reef. And now I will tell you a story before I go into deep with this method, and I will share with you how this idea came up to my mind. First of all, I am a geomorphologist with most of my research dedicated to coastal environments. For years, my research was about sea level fluctuations, and I was trying to reconstruct the sea level of the past. My background as a geologist helped me a lot to do that, and I was using different sea level indicators. Once I was working in this environment, you see in this picture, and one of the sea level indicators I usually use is sediments from lagoons, because they are very sensitive environments and they keep a lot of information. So I was working in this area. We had drilled up to 6 meters in the lagoon, and we were working on the reconstruction of the paleogeography, which goes back to 6,000 years before the present. This evolution was amazing, and beach rocks, which can be easily noticed in this picture, were used in this study area, but also in many other areas around the world in order to calculate and understand the sea level changes. The last day of our fieldwork activities in this area, I stayed in a nearby hill, admiring the view and the site. I was working for many years, and I thought that this would be the closure of my activities in this area. Or, in fact, I thought it would. It was a windy day with a lot of wave activity, and it was suddenly clear to my mind that these formations, beach rocks, were protecting the vulnerable coastal environment in front of them. And before I start sharing with you how we mimic the environment in order to build this kind of formations. I will explain a little bit what is beach rocks and how they are formed by the nature for those who are not familiar with this geomorphic formation. With only a few words, beach rocks are fossilized ancient beaches. Beach rocks are hard coastal sedimentary formations consisting of littoral sediments which are rapidly cemented together through the sedimentation deposition of carbonate materials, typically composed of high magnesium calcite or aragonite. This lithification takes place in the intertidal zone and can include all kinds of sediments such as sands and cobbles of clastic and biogenic origin. Beach rocks are formed even today, so it is possible to study their evolution as well as their diagenesis conditions. What kind of material do we find in beach rocks? Any kind of material you may find in a beach, because as I mentioned before, it is a fossilized beach. And regarding their age, the best known beach rocks are late Holocene, and more specifically, 1,000 to 5,000 years old. Usually they grow in bands parallel to the beach, because as I told you, it is a former beach. They have a slight slope offshore, usually similar to the adjacent beach. And when they are found to be different, it usually indicates they are changed due to the erosion causing the beach slabs to break and tilt. Beach rocks are variable in thickness, ranging from half a meter to maybe 2 meters, even in microtidal areas. Beach rocks are hard coastal formations, as I mentioned, consisted by beach sediments, which were consolidated by cement precipitated in sediment pores. The cement, you may see it here with the red arrow, is consisted by calcite and magnesium calcite. And under a microscope and a scanning electron microscope, microphoto, we observe two sand particles, the one in the left of quartz and the other one of calcite that are binted by micreted high magnesium calcite shown with this red arrow. We have also cement coating the particles, and as the pore space is filled, more fine material is consolidated by cement and filling further the pore. And this material is called matrix, and this is what you may notice in the picture with the orange arrow. Have a look to the coastal zone. It is clearly vulnerable with sandy beach, unstabilized dune fields, anthropogenic intervention because of touristic activities, but also the reduction of the sediment supply from the drainage network that ends in the coastal zone because they have built many dams uphill. So can you see any coastal erosion? No. The same is happening in this area, which although is vulnerable and frequently receives a lot of wave activity, it does not face coastal erosion. And in this area, with again sandy beach and sand dunes and lagoons beside, and in this case, it is even more vulnerable because the lagoon is lower than the current sea level. And the same here. So what is the common in all these different sites? The answer is beach rocks. geomorphologist already knew that the beach rocks protect the coastal zone, and we had examples where big hotels removed beach rocks in order to offer to visitors a sandy passage to the sea, and in less than 10 years, they lost the beach. Humans talk about mitigation and adaptation, but nature itself shows us the way to sustainable adaptation. This protective mechanism is there for about 5,000 years, protecting the coastline. And we know that because we have dated the beach rocks, this formation. You can notice also in this picture that we have more than one series of beach rocks. Each of the series corresponds to a beach of a different period. Sea level was rising, both because of static, but also for tectonic reasons, and the fossilized beach was found submerged. The new beach became active and gradually was also fossilized, forming a new beach rock. The sea level was rising again, and the beach rock was drawn. And this happened many times. In fact, we have mapped five ancient beaches submerged in this area. So it became clear to my mind that the nature has shown the way, and beach rocks could be the idea to protect our beaches. Few years later, I started the project Nature for Nature with the collaboration of University of Hokkaido in Japan. And Yannis Saitis, who was a PhD student of mine at that time period, and he's here with us today, worked for many years in the lab doing several tests. I have chosen to show you this picture depicting a beach rock which is submerged at 3 meters below current sea level. Have a look how destroyed it is. This has happened because much of the wave energy crashes on this formation and at the end arrives with reduced energy to the coastline. So let's see what we are doing in order to mimic what nature is doing. Here you may notice our methodology, which is divided generally in three main steps: fieldwork, laboratory analysis, and then combination of data. There are many dominant theories of beach rock formation, and one of them is biological activity. This is what we use in order to create beach rock. Bacteria and algae may contribute to cement consolidation. Bacteria are living on a particle surface, and they create calcite as a byproduct of their biological activity, which is ureolysis. Here you may notice what we are doing in the field. In fact, we collect sediment and seawater. Why we do that? In order to analyze this in the lab and find what kind of bacteria exist in our case study. And then analysis is taking place regarding the granulometry of the sediment, the bacteria, and in order to define the parameters. And after that, after we find which bacteria exist in the area, let's say we feed them, and we just trigger the cementing of the pre-existing sediment. So nothing new is added to the environment. We use the sediment already exists there and the bacteria already exist. We just trigger the cementing. Following, we studied the artificial beach rocks under optical polarized microscopy and SEM-EDS in order to observe the crystal growth and to identify its chemical composition. As we can see in the upper left and right figures, calcite crystals have been formed in the sediment pores. The crystal growth varies in the specimen from 10 micrometers to 50 micrometers. The bottom left and right figures are derived from SEM, which make clearer the extended calcite crystal growth between the particles and filling pores. And checking after this, the mechanical characteristics of the beach rock we created, it seems similar to the natural beach rocks. And as I mentioned before, the natural beach rocks can live in the environment for thousands of years, protecting the coastal area without any maintenance, without using cement or things like that. We just use whatever the nature can give us in each specific site. Here you may see some, if you want to go deeper to all this stuff, you may see some of the papers we have published out of about this methodology. And the idea is to mitigate coastal erosion with environmental friendly methods, to follow what nature is doing. Here is a wonderful reef to protecting a vulnerable environment in front of this, adding nothing in the environment, just using what the environment is giving us. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Nikki. That was a really fascinating talk, and a really, really lovely to see the whole idea of learning from nature and working with nature. I'm just gonna, so thank you for being with us at Researcher's Desk.